1 of the Constitution, the former President of the Republic of Zimbabwe, by written notice, has notified the Speaker of Parliament of his resignation from office of the President. And whereas in terms of paragraph 14, sub paragraph 4B of the 6th schedule of the Constitution, a vacancy in the office of the President must be filled by a nominee of the political party which the former president represented. And whereas in terms of paragraph 14, sub paragraph 5 of the 6th schedule, the ruling party, ZANU-PF, has nominated Emmerson Dambudzo Mnangagwa as the candidate, as the party's candidate to assume the office of the president. And whereas in terms of section 94 of the Constitution, the president must take before the Chief Justice the oath of president in the form set out in the third schedule. Now, therefore, I, Luke Malaba, Chief Justice of the Republic of Zimbabwe, do hereby call upon you, Emmerson Dambudzo Mnangagwa, to take the oath of president.
I, Emmerson Dambudzo Mnangagwa, swear that as President of the Republic of Zimbabwe, I will be faithful. To Zimbabwe and obey, uphold, and defend the Constitution and all other laws of Zimbabwe, and that I will promote whatever will advance and oppose whatever may harm Zimbabwe, that I will protect and promote the rights of the people of Zimbabwe. That I will discharge my duties with all my strength to the best of my knowledge and ability, and true to the dictates of my conscience, and that I will devote myself to the well-being of Zimbabwe and its people. So help me God.
job.
Thank you, my brother.
Thank you.
That's good. Thank you. Congratulations. Excellent.
Zimbabwe, you've just seen there the swearing in to office of the new His Excellency, the President of the Republic of Zimbabwe, Comrade Emmerson Nambudzo Mnangagwa. His Excellency, the President of the Republic of Zimbabwe, Comrade Emmerson Nambudzo Mnangagwa, has just taken oath of office. He is the third President of the Republic of Zimbabwe. And this has just happened in the giant national sports stadium filled to capacity. Thousands among thousands of Zimbabweans cheering on as we enter a new era. A new dawn for Zimbabwe. The Chief Justice, Honorable Lukma Laba, has just presided in the swearing in into office of the new President of the Republic of Zimbabwe. And right now, as you can see, it is the adorning of the sash. Ladies and gentlemen, wherever you are watching this live, we have just entered a new dawn in this country. Zimbabwe has a new president. His name is Comrade Emmerson Nambudzo Mnangagwa. Joining us, here are several heads of states. We know the president of Zambia, Edgar Lungu, is among us. We know the president of Botswana is also here, Ian Khama. We have several heads of states and governments who have joined us in this auspicious occasion. And as FBC, we are proud to give you these events live from the National Sports Stadium. Next up, we will see Commander Defense Forces and Service Chiefs paying their compliments to the Commander-in-Chief of the Zimbabwe Defense Forces, His Excellency Comrade Emmerson Dambudzo Mnangagwa. We also see Pledge of Allegiance by the Commander Defense Forces and Service Chiefs being Commander of the Defense Forces, Commissioner General of Zimbabwe Republic Police, and Commissioner General of Prisons and Correctional Services. This is live.
The ceremony has now been completed. The Commander of Defense Forces and Service Chiefs will now pay their compliments to the Commander-in-Chief of the Zimbabwe Defense Forces, His Excellency Comrade Emmerson Dambudzo Mnangagwa. Please be seated.
Your Excellency, I, Constantine Kuvea Dominic Nyikadzino Chiwenga, Commander of the Defense Forces of Zimbabwe, on behalf of all officers, men and women of the Zimbabwe Defense Forces, do hereby solemnly and sincerely swear, affirm and declare our true loyalty to you, Your Excellency, the President of the Republic of Zimbabwe and Commander-in-Chief of the Zimbabwe Defense Forces, and that we will be faithful and bear true allegiance to Zimbabwe and to the laws of Zimbabwe. So help me God.
We shall now have the Commissioner General of the Zimbabwe Republic Police to make his pledge.
Your Excellency, I, Augustine Chiuri, Commissioner General of Police, on behalf of all the officers, men and women of the Zimbabwe Police Service, do hereby solemnly and sincerely swear, affirm and declare our true loyalty to you, Your Excellency, the President of the Republic of Zimbabwe and Commander-in-Chief of the Zimbabwe Defense Forces, and that we will be faithful and bear true allegiance to Zimbabwe and the laws of Zimbabwe.
The next Commander's Commissioner of Prisons and Correctional Service will now make his pledge.
Your Excellency. I, Paradzai Williams Mondi, Commissioner General of the Zimbabwe Prisons and Correctional Service, on behalf of all officers, men and women of the Zimbabwe Prisons and the Correctional Service, do hereby solemnly and sincerely swear, affirm and declare our true loyalty to you, Your Excellency, the President of the Republic of Zimbabwe and Commander-in-Chief of the Zimbabwe Defense Forces, and that we will be faithful and bear true allegiance to Zimbabwe and to the laws of Zimbabwe. So help me God.
First Lady.
What's he?
Your Excellency Auxilium Mnangagwa joins the new President of Zimbabwe at the sharing podium. Can we have now the family members of His Excellency the President to come forward and congratulate His Excellency? Just hold on.
Yes. We are still here at the National Sports Stadium where we've just witnessed the swearing-in of the new President of the Republic of Zimbabwe, Comrade Emmerson Dambudzo Mnangagwa. And right now we've just witnessed the pledging of allegiance by the Commander of Defence Forces and Service Chiefs, the Commander of the Defence Forces, the Commissioner General of the Zimbabwe Republic Police, the Commissioner General of Prisons and Correctional Services. And we've also seen the First Lady congratulating the new First Lady, congratulating His Excellency, the new President of the Republic of Zimbabwe. And we now await for the playing of the national anthem and fly past.
Ladies and gentlemen, comrades and friends, countrymen, I feel deeply humbled by the decision of my party, ZANU-PF, inviting me to serve our great nation, the Republic of Zimbabwe, in the capacity of President and Commander-in-Chief of the Zimbabwe Defense Forces with effect from today. I admit that I hold no particularly unique qualification which sets me apart from the deep pool of able citizens of our party and our land, who otherwise could have been chosen to occupy this onerous office. But even as I make constant reference to my party ZANU-PF, I'm not oblivious to the many Zimbabweans from across the political, ethnic, and racial divide who have helped make this day and thus have legitimate expectations from the office now I occupy. The decision of my party is merely for the purpose of political identification, as I intend, nay, am required to serve our country as the president of all citizens, regardless of color, creed, religion, tribe, totem, or political affiliation. Let me at this stage pay special tribute to one of and the only surviving founding father of our nation, Comrade Robert Gabriel Mugabe. He led us in our struggle for national independence. He assumed responsibilities of leadership at the formative and a very challenging time at the birth of our nation. That is to be lauded and celebrated for all times. Whatever errors of commission or omission that might have occurred during that critical phase in the life of our nation, let us all accept and acknowledge his immense contribution towards the building of our nation. To me personally, he remains a father, mentor, comrade in arms, and my leader. We thus say thank you to him and a trust that our history will grant him his proper place and accord him his deserved stature as one of the founding fathers and leaders of our nation. Let me also recognize in a very, very special way the presence in our midst of senior statesmen of our region and the continent, led by His Excellency, former President Kenneth David Kaunda of Zambia, he remains the only living member of the Foundational Frontline States grouping, which is synonymous with the decolonization process in our region. We honor him as indeed we remember all his colleagues now departed. The statesmen who are with us today show a story of success. May I repeat that? Show a story of succession which speaks well of our continent. It is a narrative that must get bolder and bolder as generations hand over to succeeding ones, all in amity. In acknowledging the honor you have bestowed upon me, I recognize that the urgent tasks that beckon will not be accomplished through speeches. I must hit the ground running. We all need to summon and unleash in consent towards taking this great nation beyond where our immediate past president left it. For close to two decades, this country went through many developments. Whilst we cannot change the past, there is a lot we can do in the present and the future to give our nation a different positive direction. As we do so, we should never remain hostages of our past. I thus humbly appeal to all of us that we let bygones be bygones, readily embracing each other in defining a new destiny of our beloved Zimbabwe. The task at hand is that of rebuilding our great country. It principally lies with none but ourselves to do so. I implore you all to declare that never again should circumstances that have put Zimbabwe in an unfavorable position be allowed to recur or overshadow its prospects. We must work together. You, me, all of us who make up this nation. Ours is a great country, endowed with rich resources and abounding in many opportunities for everyone who considers Zimbabwe as a home. Whilst I am aware that emotions and expectations might be high and mixed, I have no doubt that over time we will appreciate the solid foundation laid by my predecessor against all manner of vicissitudes towards building an educated, enlightened, skilled, and forgiving society. This is a formidable head start we draw from our past, a plinth upon which to build developments in the present and to erect hopes for the future. Fellow countrymen, Zimbabweans, as we chart our way forward, we must accept that our challenges as a nation emanate in part from the manner in which we have managed our politics, both nationally and internationally. However, given our historical realities, we wish the rest of the world to understand and appreciate that the policies and programs related to land reform were inevitable. Whilst there is a lot we may need to do by way of outcomes, the principle of repossessing our land cannot be challenged or reversed. The dispossession of our ancestral lands was the fundamental reason for waging the liberation struggle. It would be a betrayal of the brave men and women who sacrificed their lives if we were to reverse the gains we have made in reclaiming our land. Therefore, I exhort beneficiaries of the land reform program to show their deservedness by demonstrating commitment to the utilization of the land now available to them for national food security and for the recovery of our economy. They must take advantage of programs that my government shall continue to avail to ensure that all land is utilized optimally. To that end, my government will capacitate the Land Commission so that it is seized with all outstanding issues related to land redistribution. My government is committed to compensating those farmers from whom land was taken in terms of our laws of land. As we go into the future, complex issues of land tenure will have to be addressed both urgently and definitively. We dare not prevaricate on this key issue. Events leading to this historic day attest to the fact that we are a unique nation, one which is clear about what it wants and what it does not want. Ordinarily, many nations, including those in the developed world, would not have ended with the sort of outcome we celebrate today. Credit goes to every Zimbabwean and to my predecessor who invested a lot towards a peaceful resolution of the challenges of the situation that had arisen in our country. From events preceding this occasion, we stand apart as a unique nation driven by mutual tolerance, peace and unity, which we have displayed in the past few weeks. This is a wonder to the world, indeed a proud page we have added to the science of conflict resolution and settlement. That peace and harmony should be characteristic of how we relate to one another before, during, and after the 2018 harmonized democratic elections next year. I commit to you today that these elections will be held as scheduled. Today, however, the Republic of Zimbabwe renews itself. My government will work towards ensuring that the pillars of democracy in our land are strengthened and respected. We fully reaffirm our membership of the family of nations and express our commitment to playing our part in all regional, continental, and international organizations and arrangements in order to make our modest contribution towards a prosperous and a peaceful world order. We subscribe and affirm the principle where all nations of the world are equal and sovereign partners working towards the maintenance of world peace as collectively cherished under the United Nations Charter. Here at home, we must, however, appreciate the fact that over the years, our domestic politics had become poisoned and rancorous and polarizing. My goal is to persuade and preside over a polity and run an administration that recognizes strength in our diversity as a people, hoping that this position, a well-meant stance, will be reciprocated and radiated to cover all our groups, organizations, and communities. We dare not squander the moment. Whatever we do or choose not to do must be intended to benefit all our people. Above all, we must always remember and realize that we hold and run this country in trust. It belongs to future generations whose possibilities must never be foreclosed or mortgaged as a result of decisions of expediency. The values of unity and peace cherished by all Zimbabweans are the enduring foundations for the desired goal of development. is the third pillar of the Trinity: unity, peace, and development, espoused by my party's NPF. Our economic policy will be predicated on our agriculture, our command agriculture, which is the mainstay, and on creating conditions for an investment-led economic recovery that puts a premium on job creation. Key choices will have to be made to attract foreign direct investment, to tackle high levels of unemployment while transforming our economy. The main skilled Zimbabweans who have left the country over the years for a variety of reasons must now come into the broad economic calculus designed for our recovery and the takeoff as a nation. Of course, the fiscal and the social infrastructure must be repaired and expanded to position our country in readiness for economic growth, employment creation, equity, freedom, and democracy, and for the provision of vital social goals, principally health, shelter, clean water, education, and other key social services. Our quest for economic development must be premised on our timeless goal to establish and sustain a just and equitable society firmly based on our historical, cultural, and social experience, as well as on our aspirations for better lives for all our people. Our system of economic organization and management will incorporate elements of the market economy in which enterprise is allowed, encouraged, and protected. The fabulous natural resources we have as a country must now be exploited for the national good. We welcome mutually gainful partnerships with international investors whose presence in our midst must be valued and secured. The bottom line is an economy which is back on its feet. Only that way can we recover this economy, create jobs for our youths, and reduce poverty for all our people who must witness real positive changes in our lives. In the immediate, the liquidity challenges which have bedeviled the economy must be tackled head on, with real solutions being generated as a matter of urgency. People must be able to access their earnings and their savings as and when they need them. As we focus on recovering our economy, we must shed misbehaviors and the acts of indiscipline which have characterized the past. Acts of corruption must stop. Where these occur, swift justice must be served. We have to aspire to be a clean nation, one sown to high moral standards and deserve rewards. On these ideals, my administration declares full commitment, warning that grief awaits those who depart from the path of virtue and a clean business. To our civil servants, it cannot be business as usual. You now have to roll up your sleeves in readiness to deliver. We have an economy to recover, a people to save. Each and every one of us must now end their hour, their day, their week, and their month at work. Gone, gone are the days of absenteeism and sultry application, days of unduly delay and forestalling decisions and services in the hope of extorting dirty rewards. Those days are over. A new culture must now inform and animate our daily conduct. Our offices must speedily answer questions and generate solutions awaited by our customers, be they our citizens or well-meaning outsiders who want to join in our economic recovery. Flexibility must be built into our operations so that the machine of government does not become one huge, ponderous stumbling block to decisions that must be made and communicated expeditiously. The culture of government must change, and change now. Recognizing the pivotal role that exports play in generating much-needed foreign currency, government will ensure relaxation of export procedures whilst vigorously ensuring the reduction of all costs associated with the conduct of international trade. The establishment of special economic zones will be accelerated in order to attract investment and increase exports. The maintenance of economic stability and confidence amongst the transacting public, the local business community, and foreign investors remains key to our reform agenda. My government will ensure financial sector viability and stability. We will put in place measures that encourage saving through bank deposits and other appropriate financial instruments, which bring fair rewards to depositors. The current banking culture, where costs are left on depositors, must come to an end. To reduce the high country risk perception among existing and prospective investors, government will henceforth ensure that its domestic and internal debt obligations are serviced. This will apply to the whole of government, including local authorities and state-owned enterprises. In addition, my government will proactively curb externalization of foreign currency and the smuggling of goods. The country's border management and control systems will be strengthened. I intend to approach security issues from a broad human, physical, and social perspective. All citizens must feel secure and enjoy a sense of belonging in their land. All activities that the national security institutions aim to achieve must be focused on overall human security, to include, among others, security from disease, hunger, unemployment, illiteracy, and extreme poverty. We must pay equal attention to all these areas enhancing the capabilities of our security services so that they are able to deal decisively with all threats. Today, the Republic of Zimbabwe enters the second phase of its birth. We emerge to fully affirm our belonging to the family of nations. We harbor no ill or belligerent intentions against any other nation. The Southern African Development Community, SADC, is our home. We founded it from its beginning, and we recommit ourselves to furthering its vision and ideals. As we journey outward from our SADC house, we fully realize that we belong in the bigger house and family, the African Union. Once we were not free at the birth of the OAU, which championed the total liberation of the entire African continent from colonialism, we were creators of sterling efforts of the OAU through its Liberation Committee. The African Union itself, the sequel to the OAU, is our natural home and a collective resource as Africans. Zimbabwe pledges its untrammeled membership and declares here and now that it will play its role fully to make a success of the AU. An important subset of the AU is the COMESA Economic Group of Nations. There, we are committed to contributing meaningfully to the realization of the AU Agenda 2063. Zimbabwe's journey since independence has provided us with many lessons, some pleasant, others not so pleasant. In particular, some bigger nations have attempted to make us bend to their dictates. We have, however, successfully maintained good relations with the preponderant majority of the family of nations. I stand here today to say that our country is ready and willing for a steady re-engagement with all the nations of the world. As we build a new democratic Zimbabwe, we ask those who have punished us in the past to reconsider their economic and political sanctions against us. Whatever misunderstandings may have subsisted in the past, let this make way for a new beginning. In this global world, no nation is, can, or need be an island. Isolation has never been splendid or viable. Solidarity and partnerships are and will always be the way. We are ready to embrace each and all on the principles of mutual respect and common humanity. We will take definite steps to re-engage those nations who have had issues with us in the past. Equally, we will take measures to ensure that we acknowledge and show commitment towards settling our debts. But of course, our resources remain sparse, especially at this stage when we face a myriad of pressures. But we count on the goodwill of those we owe to give us a chance. We remain committed to honoring the debts and to entering into new relationships. I wish to be clear. All foreign investments will be safe in Zimbabwe. we will willfully abide by the terms of bilateral investment promotion and protection agreements, which we have concluded with a number of nations. I ask you to join us in exploiting our potential to make a difference in the lives of our people. The United Nations is the home of all the nations on this planet. We will contribute to the overall thinking and management of world affairs. Our plain talk arises from our deep convictions and desire to help build world peace. We join the rest of the continent in calling for reforms in the United Nations system so the world body becomes truly representative and thus commands universal respect. Zimbabwe will continue to contribute to international peace and security, urging the granting of full statehood and freedoms to the Palestinian and Sahrawi peoples. Let us together honestly address the sources of instability and terrorism in many parts of the world, all within the framework of the United Nations. Honorable guests and people of Zimbabwe, I wish to thank all of you here and elsewhere who wished us a peaceful transition. For the time that I shall be president of Zimbabwe, I solemnly promise that I shall, to the best of my ability, serve everyone who calls and considers Zimbabwe their home. I encourage all of us to remain peaceful, even as preparations for political contestations for next year's harmonized, free and fair elections gather momentum. The voice of the people is the voice of God. Brothers and sisters, the people of Zimbabwe, the task before us is much bigger than competing for political office. Let us all play our part to build this great country together as Zimbabweans. May God bless Zimbabwe. I thank you.
A big round of applause for the address by the President. Zimbabwe oye! Zimbabwe oye! Zimbabwe oye! Thank you, thank you.
The address there, the inaugural address by His Excellency the President, Comrade Emmerson Dambudzo Mnangagwa, finishing his address there by saying the task here at hand is bigger than competing for any